We raced this Mazda MX-5 around Donington Park and the whole thing was almost completely carbon neutral. Keep watching to find out how we did it.
Despite the recent announcement to push back on the ban on the sale of combustion engine cars in the UK, the general consensus is that fossil fuels will, at some point, become a thing of the past. Electric vehicles, we're told, are the future. But what about all the cars that already run on petrol and diesel? Is there a way to make them as, if not more, environmentally friendly than an EV?
Well, allow me to explain the concept behind synthetic fuels. Just like regular petrol from your local pump, they take the form of a flammable liquid that ignites, pushes down a piston, and turns a crankshaft. However, unlike regular fossil fuels that deliver additional CO2 into the atmosphere, synthetic fuels can power an engine and at the same time be almost completely carbon neutral.
It sounds almost too good to be true. So to find out first if it actually works, we've entered this Mazda MX-5 into a 2-hour endurance race at Donington Park with the 750 Motor Club. And this car is run entirely on fossil-free fuels provided by P1 Fuels. We've got qualifying in 10 minutes, so I'm gonna go and get ready.
Now, like a proper racing driver, I'm gonna get my excuses in early, as while I've raced around Donington many times before, I've never, ever driven this car. We're racing in the 750 Motor Club Club Enduro Series, where there's a wide variety of rival cars, yet I'm almost certain we're the only ones using synthetic fuels. It's not as uncommon in motorsport as you'd think though, because in 2022 the WRC became the first FIA World Championship to adopt a 100% sustainable fuel supplied by P1, and it certainly doesn't seem to be holding them back. So in theory, we should have no excuses.
So qualifying over, it went quite well actually. We qualified P3 out of I think around 8 cars, which is pretty good going, especially since it was the first time I've driven the car. It was wet, greasy, first time on those tyres, but it felt really pretty good. We got a slightly sticky clutch, which we're going to keep an eye on for the race. But the fuel, I mean, if you hadn't have told me it was a petrol car, a regular petrol car, I wouldn't have believed it. So early impressions are very good. Now just wait around for the race and go and have a bacon sandwich, I guess.
Qualifying done, and we've got a few hours to kill before the race starts. So, let's go into a little bit more detail on the science behind the fuel itself. Matt Simonite, the owner of the MX-5 and co-driver for today, talks me through it.
Right, so I'm here with Matt Simonite, who is partnered with P1 Fuels. He's also the owner of the MX-5 that we're going to be racing today. And what I wanted to do, Matt, is just ask you a couple of questions about the fuel and the science behind it and the feasibility, because it's a really interesting concept, but I think there's a lot of people that are going to want to know more about how it works. So tell me, how is this fuel carbon neutral?
So there's a few ways it can be created into a carbon neutral fuel. So the main phrase you'll have heard is e-fuels. So there's e-fuels and there's also biosynthetic carbon neutral fuels. So your biosynthetics are sort of like waste feedstocks and organic material to create the base, so the ethanol and the methanols. Whereas e-fuels are more carbon capture from industry or carbon capture machines. So there's slight differences in them, but ultimately they produce the same sort of product, so carbon neutral petroleum. The product we use from P1 is a blend of synthetic and e-fuel, so it's a bit of both. It gets the easiest balance at this point in production, using some biosynthetic base and some carbon capture from industry. So any of the carbon that's in it has either been captured by a plant, yeah, and then recycled into the fuel. It's a byproduct of industry which would have been vented into, yeah, the atmosphere, or it's been plucked out of the atmosphere via a carbon capture machine. So any carbon in it has come out the air at, right, some stage, or would have gone into the air and is back in the fuel, yeah, to then be released. That's the basics, okay, behind it.
So am I right in thinking that it's going to bring down, you know, if you suddenly put it in all the fuel tanks of the cars tomorrow, you could drop it in and it would bring down the world CO2 level, but would you still get localized CO2 or?
Yeah, so you still release it from the tailpipe, yeah, which is one of the main points that skeptics have about this. You don't have the benefit of an EV where there's no tailpipe emissions. There is still tailpipe emissions. But as you've just sort of touched on, as we grow as a population and as more cars go on the road, the new CO2 being released by fossil fuels will keep increasing. But if theoretically you replace them all with synthetic fuel overnight, that figure would stay the same, because we're pulling that carbon out of the atmosphere, putting it back in the atmosphere, pulling it back out of the atmosphere. So you'd sort of cap it at where it is now.
Yeah.
So it's a net reduction, because the forecasted increase wouldn't happen. You'd be plateauing at whatever the millisecond sort of amount that's in the atmosphere is now.
Yeah.
So that's the ideal situation.
Yeah.
The scale you'd need to do that would be humongous.
Yeah.
And that is probably not what it's going to do, but it would subsidise EV production. It would help develop that. So, because we're high on EV demand at the minute, but infrastructure isn't keeping pace with that. Synthetic fuels and hydrogen could come in as extra components to decarbonising mobility.
Yeah.
What we like to say is it's not synthetic fuels and hydrogen against EV.
Yeah.
It's everything needs to be an option. It's all the cards have got to be on the table.
Yeah.
We can't use one technology to solve this problem. It's not going to work. And what we're trying to do is sort of highlight that a little bit more in terms of demonstrating how it'll work in a vehicle with standard fuel system and all that. So
Okay, and what needs to happen for this to become a widespread viable solution that you can put in your everyday car, and for it to cost a similar amount to how much you pay for regular fuels now? Because I'm guessing that this is a bit more expensive.
Yeah, so it's probably 3 times the price of sort of regular fuel. So this is a 97 octane, so it's like super unleaded.
Yeah.
It's about 3 times the cost of super unleaded at the minute. Scale brings that down, and scale is happening. So P1 are expanding the production capabilities, and there's other players in the market. So there's multiple other brands who are also doing similar. It's literally time and scale. It will come down. Forecasts are saying 2 to 3 years now, it'll be comparable price to pump fuel. And I think if we can get there, it's a no-brainer for people to have that option on the table. This product's already EN228 accredited, so it could go into a fuel station anywhere and be sold under current regulation, no problem.
Cool.
We could have spoken a lot longer about the science behind the fuels, but one, we had a race to run, and two, I wanted to talk you through the car we'll actually be driving in the race.
So what we've got here is a Mark III Mazda MX-5. Not entirely sure what year it is, but it's converted from road use into a racing car. It looks the part, it's a really lovely wrap on it. And under the bonnet, it's got a 2-litre naturally aspirated petrol engine, makes about 160 to 165 horsepower, somewhere in the region of that. And it's fueled exclusively by P1 fuels, carbon neutral, all very impressive. And hopefully, fingers crossed, everything goes well in the race with it. The brakes, we've got PBS brake pads front and rear. The tyres are Yokohama AO52s, which actually work quite well in the wet this morning. I was surprised. And then in the dry, they should be right on the money. So looking forward to trying those out. And this is the pièce de résistance of this car. If you just have a look at the interior, because a lot of racing cars around this level, the interiors are pretty bare and basic. Not that nice to sit in, really, but this, I mean, this is luxurious. You've got an armrest, you've got cup holders, it's got leather trimmed handbrake, it's got power steering, it's got ABS. It's lovely. It's actually a really nice car to sit in and drive. It feels comfortable, which hopefully will mean that it'll be perfect for doing a 2-hour endurance race in. It's even got parking sensors. They're not plumbed in, and I'm hoping that we don't really feel like we need them in a race. But yeah, they're there if you ever wanted them. I mean, it's quite a simple car. It's straightforward, but that's what you need for racing. Gas Gold, forgot those. Gas Gold dampers as well. Really good dampers. They're set to Super Cup spec on the BRSCC Super Cup series. They've got lots of levels of adjustment. We've got quite a neutral setup on this car, but it should be good, especially considering that I've not really driven it. So nice,
usable, easy to drive car for this endurance race. Fingers crossed, it starts pretty soon. So again, I'm gonna go off and get ready and I'll see you in a bit.
Lining up in the assembly area, I knew the aim for the race was to hold it steady and test out the fuel, but even so, I was nervous. It was a big grid with some very quick cars, plus the opening laps would be the first time I'd ever driven the car in the dry. Nevertheless, I got off to a solid start, kept my nose out of trouble, and settled in for the hour-long stint. It was all going very well, until it wasn't.
So, slightly earlier finish to the race than I was hoping for and expecting. Car was going well, felt really good, and then six, seven laps in, as you can hear, the cars are still going round. Started to get an issue with the clutch, and as it turned out, gearbox. Started crunching gears, pedal wasn't returning, and then we'd lost all gears apart from second, and I think maybe fifth was still working, but not much you can do with that. That's a shame, but it's also motorsport. From a fuel point of view, can't fault it, really. We still need to see how much fuel is left in the tank, so we can compare that to how much you'd use with regular Shell or BP fuel. But it was smooth as silk, nothing that seemed awry. Again, as I said, you wouldn't know driving it that it is a different kind of fuel entirely. So that's got to be the most important thing. And although we only did a few laps, we also did the laps in qualifying and the engine was flawless. So from that point of view, top marks.
And so it wasn't to be in the race. That unfortunately is motorsport regardless of what kind of fuel you're running. Unless of course it's an EV and it doesn't have a gearbox, but you know, small details. The fossil free fuel and the science behind it clearly works. This is evident from today, but also from the other numerous in-depth tests the fuel has been through. It's not perfect, as Matt said, you still get localized pollution, and it's not the silver bullet, but the potential flexibility of the fuel is crucial, as is its ability to simply work in any existing or hopefully future petrol car. As is often the case, the challenge will be scalability, politics, and of course, cost. But from my experiences so far, this is definitely a solution that is worth our attention.